crucifixion squad. He's the centurion. I want to borrow his eyes. He was there from the very beginning, 9 a.m., Good Friday morning. That would have been like this morning, over 2,000 years ago. He was there, that Good Friday morning, and Jesus arrives on the scene, and the first thing we find that the very first words that Jesus says, which were already quoted in the video, said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Now, the Greek text seems to indicate that it took place while they were nailing him to the cross. This centurion has seen a lot of men die, and he's heard a lot of things come out of the lips of those who are being executed. He's been cursed. He's heard people blaspheme God, and he's heard people watch them spit, and he's seen them cry. He's seen them wail. He's seen it all, but he never saw anything like this. The one that he is executing lifts up a prayer to God and says, "Father, forgive." The word forgive means, it's built on the root word, which means to release and also means to destroy. And he's kind of praying like this: "Father, release them from their obligation to satisfy justice for what they are doing, and destroy that debt so it's not hanging over their heads." Is that powerful or what? "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." The Apostle Paul, right later, he'll say, "If they had known that they had crucified the Lord of glory, they would not have done it." These guys are following orders. And so he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The first thing I notice here is this centurion, through his eyes, he sees the Lord of glory dying, not like any other man that he has ever watched die before. The second saying takes place as all three of the men have been nailed to their crosses. They're lifted up, and there's some bantering going on between the two crosses on either side of Jesus. Both of these are criminals, and they're dying for the crimes that they have committed, and they start railing on Jesus. "If you're the Son of God, if you're the Christ, if you're a king, come down off the cross." He's not alone. The Bible says that all the people that gathered to watch the execution are doing the same thing. They're saying, "If you are the Christ, come down." Not only does it say that, but it also says in the text, the soldiers, the centurion and his death squad, they're saying, "If you are the Christ, if you're a king, come on, come down, come down. You're able to save others, save yourself. If you're really a king." They're bantering back and forth because they're all full of doubt. Their expectation of the Messiah, the king, is that he would throw off the Roman government, not be executed by the Roman government. And so we have the two criminals on either side of Jesus, but I think these three crosses right here, they represent all of humanity, all of humanity. You have one cross, I'll call it the cross of rejection. He doubts and he's railing upon Jesus. In fact, they both were. And then you have in the middle cross, you have the cross of redemption. Jesus is really dying as the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world. He is the Redeemer. He's going to pay in full the price of our sins so that we can be free. And then you have a third cross, and he's as guilty as the guy on the first cross, but something happens. I call this the cross of repentance. He turns and he looks towards the other criminal, bypassing looking at Jesus. And he says to the other criminal, "What's the matter with you, man? Don't you see what's going on here? We are dying for the crimes we've committed, but this man," he looks at Jesus, says, "he's done nothing wrong." That's an interesting statement. It tells me he believes in the sinlessness of Jesus Christ, the spotless Lamb of God, to take away the sin of the world. Then he turns to Jesus as he's saying, this man has done nothing wrong. And he says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. That passage is just loaded. That statement is just loaded with truth. Your kingdom. So that means he must be a king. He's acknowledging the messiahship, the Christhood of Jesus, that he is the king of the Jews. He is the Lord of glory. He says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He believes that there is more than just this life. He believes that Jesus is going to somehow live beyond the cross, and he wants to be included in the kingdom when Jesus is alive beyond the cross. He says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus responds by saying, today you will be with me in paradise. When he repented of his sins, repentance is the tail side of the head side of salvation. I believe and I repent. I believe in Christ as my Savior, and I repent of what I used to do. And that moment, he accepted the Lord. You know what he could not do? He could not come down off the cross and get baptized. He could not come off the cross and join the church. He could not come off the cross and put in the offering plate. He could not come down off the cross and be a good person, because none of that gets you to heaven. It's right down to this. I believe, and I'm turning away from everything that I used to believe in. This is the first doubter who is turned into a believer on Good Friday. Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. The third saying comes a little while later. There at the cross, there were three Marys. Mary, the mother of Jesus, along with her sister, her name's not identified. Mary, who's the wife of Clopas, and then Mary Magdalene. And they're there observing. And there's also in that, with those four ladies, the apostle that Jesus called the beloved one, John. And so there's five there that are in Jesus' camp while everybody else is gathered around, are opposed to him. And Jesus on the cross, it says, when he saw his mother grieving and crying, brokenhearted, that her son Jesus, was there dying on the cross, but she knew it was coming from the time of his birth, because the angel had declared that he would break your heart. He's there dying on the cross, and she's in grief. And Jesus looks down from the cross, and he says, woman, here is your son. And he's kind of nodding with his head, indicating to John, because he can't use his hands. He can't use his feet. He says, here is your son. And he looks at John, and he says, John, here is your mother. Even on the cross, Jesus is sinless. He is sinless. He's keeping all the Ten Commandments that he had done his whole life, like you and I, none of us have done. But it says to honor your father and mother. And Jesus is honoring his mother. And the word honorarium is the word honor. Honor is to take care of, to pay. From the cross, Jesus is dying and he's saying to John, take care of my mother. There's no Social Security in the day. John, it's your job now as my beloved disciple. Take care of my mom. He's honoring his mother even in his death. Even in his death. It's now noon. Jesus has been hanging on the cross for 3 hours, 9 till noon. Darkness falls upon the face of the whole earth. I don't know if there was an eclipse, way scientists would place it, that there must have been an eclipse that day. I don't know if it was just that God rolled in some pretty heavy clouds and it became very dark, and that there was associated with lightning and thunder and all of that. I don't know. I just know that it was a very uncanny darkness that covered the whole land from noon until 3 o'clock. And so for those next 3 hours, while Jesus is hanging on the cross, suffering in darkness, we get to close towards the end of that first 3 hours, we come up with the fourth saying. It's interesting that in the New International Version of the Bible, they transliterate the Aramaic that was spoken by Jesus into Greek. And so it reads, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. In Aramaic, it probably went like this, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Only it was done in agony. The words are this, my God, why have you forsaken me? The answer is not given there. But something is going on here that is more profound than all the rest of the suffering that Jesus is going through. It tells us in the book of Isaiah 53 that he would be a lamb led to the slaughter, that all we like sheep have gone astray, we've turned everyone to his own way, but the Lord laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. We go a little bit further and we find in Isaiah 53 verse 10, and it says that God was pleased to bruise his son and make his soul an offering for our sins. Something is happening here. Not only is he physically dying, but he is having placed on him the sin of the world, and God is pouring out his wrath on Jesus in such a way that God, who is of purer eyes than to look upon our sin and iniquity, turns from him, and something happens here between the Father and the Son. There is a separation between the two that they have never, ever experienced for all eternity. Jesus pays the price of our sin. And he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? The Apostle Paul said, God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might become the righteousness of God. Peter says, he died the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to himself. What was happening was Jesus was dealing with our sin. It is so exhausting. These next few items happen almost in rapid succession. Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Then he turns and he says, I am thirsty. The soldiers there take a sponge and mix it with wine and vinegar. They get this jar of that there and they put a sponge on it and they lift it up to his lips because physically he is exhausted and he is dying. The form of execution wasn't normally, normally they don't die as quickly as Jesus did, but something was going on here. His pain was so great. The burden he carried was so large, and he's exhausted physically, and he's thirsty. It was designed so that you would suffocate. You would hang on the cross, and it would cause all the muscles across your chest to constrict and pull down and collapse your lungs. And so you would push up on your feet, on those nails in your feet, so you could gasp for a breath and you'd come back down. Later they would go by and they would break the legs of the victim so that he couldn't lift up. But we'll find later that Jesus didn't need his legs broken because he died. But at this point, he's physically in anguish because of the physical pain, but also because he's bearing our sins and he says, I thirst. I thirst. Right after that, it says that he cried out with a loud voice. He must have pushed himself up, got a good breath of wind, and he cried out. In Greek, it is one word, tetelestai. It is finished. It's in the perfect tense, so it means this. It is finished once and for all. What is done now has an abiding result forever. What I have done on the cross, he says, I have paid in full the price of our sins. It is finished. That's what you would have stamped on a last payment, paid in full. You made the last mortgage payment, paid in full. You paid off your card, paid in full. Jesus said, I have paid in full the debt we owe for our sins, once and for all. It is finished. It is finished. Immediately after that came the seventh saying, the last one from the cross. Jesus says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. These are words of trust. Now don't forget, the centurion is watching all this. He's seeing everything that's taking place. He's listening to every word. In fact, the one gospel said he was standing right in front of the cross when he said these last two things. He's standing right there and he's witnessing all this. He sees a man at the beginning who forgives, and he sees a man at the end as he's giving out his last breath saying, I put my trust in you, O Father. Never once misdirecting any of his hostility, anger. Nope, there was none. No misdirection of his faith. No, it's always in the Father. And then it says, Jesus gave up the ghost, King James, or Jesus died. He died. In Matthew it says, or in Mark, the other gospel, the synoptic gospel, it says this, when the centurion saw how he died, he said, surely this man was the Son of God. Isn't that amazing? He was a doubter in the beginning, and now he's a believer. You see, Good Friday made this doubter into a believer. And I want to suggest that Good Friday can remove your doubts too. All you have to do is believe. When we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, all that he did on Good Friday is put to our account. Our sins are forgiven. We have an acceptance with God and life eternal in Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we have rehearsed what Jesus did on that first Good Friday. We're so very mindful and very thankful that he did that for us. It increases and it builds our faith to know that what he did for a purpose. He looked beyond all the pain, all the anguish, all the suffering, and he looked at us and he said, I love you so much, I will endure all this for you. Just believe in me. Lord, remove our doubts. Make us a people of faith. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand.
Surveyed by one cross, I wish the friend.
because it was hastening on to the Sabbath day, Joseph of Arimathea, along with Nicodemus, requested for the body of Jesus so they could take it down from the cross. And they took and laid it in a borrowed tomb, just as Isaiah 53 had predicted. And they sealed the tomb with a great stone. Of course, the high priest and the priest, they all went and to Pilate and all and said, hey, you know, this guy said that after 3 days he would raise from the dead. So we need you to set a garrison of soldiers there, because what if the disciples come and steal away the body? And the latter situation, that rumors around that he actually rose from the dead, is greater than the fact that we killed him, okay? And so he said, oh, you guys, you're afraid of the dead even, you know? He said, but he sealed the tomb. Now, the sealing of the tomb is kind of like on a crime scene we have today. What they would do is they would take and put a rope across it, and then there was like a wax clay substance that they put on both sides, and they put a seal on it, and they strung it so that if that was broken, they know it was tampered with. And so they sealed the tomb, and then they set a post of Roman soldiers to guard it. And so for the remainder of Friday, the remainder of all day Saturday, Jesus was dead in the tomb. Somebody said it may be Friday, but Sunday is coming. Because on Sunday morning, it says, on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. Jesus rose from the dead. Last line on here is we want to invite you to join us on Easter Sunday at 10 a.m. when we explore. If Good Friday makes doubters into believers, Easter Sunday makes believers into winners. And we're going to find out how we are winners in Jesus. We're winners. I want to invite you to come back on Easter Sunday, 10 a.m. Let's pray. Father in heaven, dismiss us with your blessing. Just have our hearts warm to know all that Jesus did because he loved us. And that you love us, O Father. This was the demonstration of your love. You so loved the world, you gave your one and only Son. You demonstrated it by having him sacrificed for us. Jesus loved us so much, he said, I lay my life down for you. If I lay it down, I can take it up again. Lord, we will celebrate that on Sunday. But today we reflect on what a great price Jesus paid that we might have a personal relationship with you, O Lord. That we might know that our sins are forgiven. We might have peace in our heart. To know that in the end we win because Jesus has already secured the winning for us. May we leave with confidence and a joy in our heart that we serve Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. God bless you and have a good Friday.